Rather than talk about you, I thought, Dan, that you could talk about your, I know that you're a vet, but maybe you could tell others about yourself and then maybe start the conversation.
Thank you. So I live in Concord. I grew up actually in Epping, New Hampshire. Served in the Army for 6 years, one tour in Afghanistan. And just want to echo the appreciation that I have for everyone to come out to screen that with us and then to participate in today's conversation. And before we kick it off with a question, just want to lay out a couple of ground rules to enable us to have this kind of conversation. And the first is, I just want to echo what Don said earlier, which is at any point in time, feel free to leave, step outside, take a break. Hope that you come back in to rejoin the conversation. And the second, the goal of this conversation isn't to arrive at the truth. Oh, sure. So the goal of this conversation isn't to convince anybody of anything. I'm not going to try to persuade anybody of any single truth. But it's rather to help us all maybe arrive at a better understanding of what the Vietnam War experience was and is for all of us. And so with that in mind, we definitely hope that people will respond to each other and that the conversation will flow organically. A helpful prompt to kind of keep us in that mindset of understanding might be if someone says something that evokes something in you and you want to speak to it, think about leading off with, help me understand what it is you're saying, or help me understand. That way we kind of are continuing to have a productive conversation. The third note is that we do hope to have a lot of perspectives shared. We all have our own individual, we are all experts of our own experience, of our own perspective, and so we want everyone to feel comfortable speaking. And we want to have time for as many people who want to share a story to share a story. So just as you're talking, if I don't come back to you, it's not because I don't value what you're saying or what you have said, just hoping to get as many perspectives in as possible. And the last thing to keep in mind is that as this unfolds, think about challenging ideas versus challenging people, right? Obviously, this is a very powerful experience and something that, unlike a lot of other things in history, is still very much with all of us, and certainly many people in the audience right now. This was not just a movie. This was their life, and it is a life. So challenging the ideas that might be raised opposed to the person. So we have Becky here with a microphone. And so the first question to kick things off is, what was the most impactful scene for you? Was any of the scenes that just kind of evoked the strongest emotional response or made you think of something? Would love to hear about someone's experience.
My name's Michael Kass, and it was the very last scene, actually, with the North Vietnamese soldier coming home and not being willing or able to celebrate. Contrasting that with Americans who came in, who were celebrating the plane and so forth, and how many American lives were lost as well, and how that must have felt for families who lost their family members in the Vietnam War.
Yeah, thank you, Michael. What did that scene, the contrast from the one to the other, what else did it prompt in you, or did it make you feel about it? What was your next thought about it?
I actually thought the reaction of the North Vietnamese was more appropriate. And because it just didn't seem like there was any victory anywhere at all. That was my take on it.
And there's that opening segment where the person says, the only people who haven't fought in war talk about winning and losing. So what was an impactful scene for someone?
Thank you. My name is David Joy. I served in the Army in 1969 in Vietnam. The most impactful statement to me was to see the prisoners of war coming home. It was very, very touching for me. That's the first time a tear came to my eye. And the just like this gentleman, the North Vietnamese
say single, like, most important, affecting scene for me, because, like, one, I've never served in the military, nor was I alive during the Vietnam War, but one thing that did strike a chord, one scene that did strike a chord with me among many was the scene of Nixon's speech and the sequence about him, like, those who were, like, supposed to be conducting the Vietnam War, turning it into a political issue and not so much a human issue, and that we see, like, stuff like that in our country today, like, talking about world events, stuff that affects our lives, and with the and, like, making it sound as if you don't believe this, then you're in the wrong, you're in a traitor, your opinion doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, there's a lot of things that we can talk about in contemporary politics today as well. Does anybody remember that speech from Nixon? Does anybody remember that, watching that, hearing that? What did you think when you first saw it, and then what did you think when you saw it here on the screen? Scene that they want to talk about that really spoke to them. So something else that kind of in what you just said made me think about is that another question for us, or would love to hear people weigh in on, do we think that the film is endorsing a certain perspective of the war? Do you think that it is trying to convey a certain message about the nature of the conflict or the morality of it? And if not, why don't you think it? Like, what makes you think it's a neutral presentation? Yes, ma'am.
I feel I'm looking forward to watching the entire series, and from the excerpts I've seen, I think it's showing all sides. I don't see anything political in this, and I'm very pleased for that. I'm just seeing the sadness. My husband went through, the Vietnamese went through. The one thing I do see, and it did hit me, is when the POWs came home, where the young white and black young soldiers together just hugging each other and just thinking, you shouldn't have to have a war for guys to do that. So I think I'm pleased with this, what we're seeing.
My name's Gary Gordon. I'm a Vietnam vet. One thing in the film to show so far that really struck me was the gentleman who said that he fears nothing now. He's seen it. He knows what real fear is. And he conducts his life that way. And that's, I think, is a trait that a lot of Vietnam vets have. I don't fear the problems I have, which are many, medical and otherwise, because, you know, it doesn't matter. I get upset, I think, more than anything else, over these people who are out bothering other people over slight things. You know, they say the wrong word or something like that. They don't know what it's really like. My wife tends to yellow or anything else under the sun. It was a thing that we all ate the same mud. I was lucky in a sense that most of my time I spent over there on an aircraft carrier. I did get in country on occasion, but I spent most of my time on an aircraft carrier. But even then, you know, we had to put up with a lot that that people just don't realize. And it's gotta, I don't know.
But and do you think the film doesn't endorse the perspective that it's not?
No, it doesn't. From what I've seen so far, I'm looking forward to watching the rest of it. I've spent quite a few years since I've been back. It was a long time before I even admitted I was a Vietnam vet. But I did spend quite a few years after that going to high schools and teaching classes and stuff like that. Not on the political part of the whole thing, but the personal part of it. I think this film does the same thing.
Yeah. I appreciate that. I think we have a gentleman up in the upper right.
Thank you. I'm a veteran of the protest against war, but I want to make it clear that I was never a critic of the soldiers or the veterans. I protested against the government, not against the soldiers. I never called you a baby killer or anything like that. And one of the moments that was really moving for me was not represented in this documentary yet. I don't know if it's there or not. But I was part of the protest during the Pentagon March of fall 1967, which occurred in the mall, and we marched to the Pentagon from there. Later on, I visited Washington again to see the memorial, and I was very glad that it was placed next to the mall, next to that scene where we also protested the war. Because I think that kind of reconciliation is really important. But, so that leads me to talk about a scene here that did bother me. The gentleman over here referred to it when he talked about Nixon and the Nixon speech and also the Spear of Agnew. It was so frustrating to be a protester against the war, because he realized more and more that official Washington was not paying attention, was not listening. Or if they were denigrating what you got to say as someone who's trying to communicate a very important point about the war. My own protest was around, I want to go back to the colonial wars of liberation that were fought in Vietnam, in Indochina, which was called then, and later Algeria, against the French. And these were wars that very much reminded me of our own Revolutionary War against a colonial power. And those colonial powers were supposed to disappear after World War II. And it was very disappointing to me to learn that the United States financed the French war in Indochina. And I think partly that was the reason we entered the war, because we had an economic investment there. And one of the things I think that occurred during the war was that despite the bombing and the devastation and the use of napalm and all that, the rubber plantations were preserved, well preserved. So we still had an economic interest there. And that's part of the problem with our involvement in that part of the world after Indochina.
Well, you raise an interesting point. We'd love to, why, for those who were alive or who have studied this, why do you think Ken Burns and Lynn Novak chose the scenes from the protests that they did? Why do you think that they chose those set of videos and images to display as opposed to others that were out there like the Pentagon one?
Well, I think the moratorium was a really important event. I wasn't there, but not in Washington anyway. But I think it was a moment of reconciliation that was allowed to pass. I mean, served that purpose, but that purpose wasn't realized. I think that was tragic.
We had a down here in the bottom left.
He was born in Canada. My ex-husband was a conscientious objector, and now for 27 years I've been married to a Vietnam veteran. But my political beliefs certainly were forming. I was a freshman, sophomore in college, and trying to figure out where I stood. I came from a privileged background where almost all of my friends went to college, so they got a deferment. My ex-husband had a deferment because he was in school, and then when we went to Canada, of course, he lost his deferment. My political beliefs have certainly started then and have continued. And when I heard Nixon's speech, which was very important to me at the time and still is very important, and Spiro Agnew, I get a better understanding of some of the divides we have now.
We had it up in the top right.
Thank you. My name is Zeke Edelson, and I'm sorry that I'm getting older and inarticulate, but I was in Vietnam in 1963 and 64. In 1963, we had 6,000 of us Americans there. And we weren't in uniform because Vietnamese didn't want us in uniform. I basically thought that we were taking care of Vietnamese as well as Americans at that time. And we all got along very well. The VC didn't bother us, and we didn't bother them, and we really didn't know who they were because they were the young men who happened to be in the country. And when I finally got out, there were about 17,000 instead of the 6,000 when we got in. And I thought about the futility of this whole thing. And that really is my message. And I don't think it has to be repeated because everyone knows about the futility of war. And certainly this one was about as bad as you could get. Thank you. I was actually in the medical corps. I was an orthopedic surgeon there. I was the only one north of Nha Trang, which is just about the middle of the southern part of the country. And so I was taking care of both sides at the same time. The nurses in our unit didn't particularly like me doing that because I would bring Vietnamese kids into our hospital because the facilities in the other hospitals weren't quite as good. But my wife just wanted to remind me of that. I think I should remind you all about the wives who stayed home. We had four kids under the age of three, and I can tell you that staying in Vietnam was better than staying at home.
My name is Susan Smith, and I'm here to represent my husband, Ken Smith. And Vietnam was a very important part of my life in that we were pen pals when he was in Vietnam. So after we met, he, when the person spoke, he came to California to meet me, and 2 days before he'd been in Vietnam. His same experience of people not responding very kindly. He also, when I saw Westmoreland, he was very, very upset with him. He felt that people were over there in the beginning and there was just no real, it was like the Wild West. And he came back, he started teacher at a local college and helped a lot of vets. And so Vietnam was really a part of my life as well. And I'm very glad that, that in the movie, it, they're presenting all sides. I'm grateful for that. Thank you.
Well, and that, I appreciate that, because that's one of the more, most notable features of this documentary series is that there are so many voices from as many perspectives as possible, and that's, how did people receive, what impact does having all of the Vietnamese perspectives have on the film? Did that kind of evoke any reaction to anyone? How do you think that, why do you think they made the decision to go and find so many people in, who are in, on the North Vietnamese side?
I'm Bill Donahue. I was a Navy corpsman from 67 to 71. Served a lot of time with the Marine Corps and was our Navy base. But I worked as an anesthesia corpsman for 2 years in Philadelphia with Marine casualties from Con Tien and those places. Got to know those struggles from their point of view. And then for a year at Camp Pendleton with Marines coming back from the Tet Offensive. And most of whom couldn't sleep at night. I'd stay up all night listening to them tell their stories. And then for my 4th year as corpsman, I went to Vietnam and I served with 2 successive combined action platoons in the bush in I Corps. There were Marine squads with Vietnamese platoons. To your question, so my last year was with Vietnamese platoons, 8 Marines and myself. Sleeping on the ground 2 hours in the middle of the daytime when we could snare it, and doing operations and ambushes every day and night. I kept records for my casualties, of which there were a fair number. All my Marines got Purple Hearts, and Vietnamese too. And they outnumbered us. I kept records in a journal for the first 6 months. The civilians, women, and the children outnumbered the military casualties, who were many, by about 8 to 1. And after 6 months, I simply stopped recording the numbers. The numbers that we heard, 2 million civilian Vietnamese, the number just rolls, you know. But I saw countless Vietnamese every day who were simply gotten away and got slaughtered in that conflict. And that had a great meaning for me.
And do you think the film does?
I think that, yeah, I understand that the rest of the film does even more in that respect, and so I'm extremely glad for that. They call it the American War. We would just quote one chapter of their 30 years of war. Their suffering, as bad as ours was, theirs was incredibly more so. So I'm glad for that inclusion, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you once again. First of all, General here, I think to clarify, a Navy corpsman spends time medic up there serving the wounded and in the throes of battle. But you asked a question earlier as to why these protest scenes in the film, why did they choose these protest scenes? And well, the short answer is I don't know. but my feeling was is that because we could, because we can. Because of our country, and we have the right of protest and free speech. And the other question about the Vietnamese presence in the films, I think, was very good. I think it's important, at least was to me, to see their feedback on our presence there and how it affected them.
Was there anything? Any particular scene? What comes to my mind as we have this kind of conversation is, you know, several things, but one of them is the idea that the denial of information that was so prevalent in the North Vietnamese country, that they didn't know what was happening, and then obviously there were the propaganda that they showed. But was there anything else that kind of stood out for you as a particular?
Actually, there was. The similarities, I guess, that I saw with the North Vietnamese political leaders in the privileged class sent their children somebody, you know, it could be a minor politician that maybe could go up the chain of command to get you out of service for some whatever reason. It was very much, you know, in the United States, a privilege who you knew could get you out of that war. It was a very, not a fair selection of the American public that fought that war.
There's a thing that's going on behind me.
My name is Helen Mallard Duchesne. One of the scenes that was in the film that I remember when it happened was of the person being just shot dead. And I was young during the Vietnam War, but I wasn't that young. And one of the things that I think about now is that I wasn't paying a whole lot of attention. And one of the things that I appreciate from this film is some of the people who are discussing going to a protest where there are only 40 people, et cetera, et cetera. And I try to think of some of the parallels in my life now, what it means to pay attention, what it means not to pay attention. But one of the other things that I've never quite understood about the Vietnam War was the folks in the room that were more involved can help me out. But it's my impression that most of the men and women that were drafted were very young and largely maybe on the less advantaged scale. But when they were called baby killers and whatnot, and I remember seeing that in the paper, and I remember hearing about that, but it reminds me, and that was never adequately explained. And how do young people that were largely unable to control their fate, how did they have to take the hit for something like that and be spit on and whatnot? And while some of us, including me, sat around and didn't do anything. And I try to think of, I'm closer to the end than the beginning, as I guess a lot of us in this room are. And I try to think of, you know, what can I take from that time of my life to make a difference in this time of my life? And I think I appreciate hearing from the folks who spoke, and I appreciate the opportunity to see these excerpts and look forward to seeing the rest of the film. But food for thought is always good, and that's what I'm getting here today.
Just did the films use, because one other thing that they do is that they also focus a lot on young North Vietnamese, and I'm wondering, did that kind of play into your thought on around seeing how young the participants?
Not so much, but you just reminded me of another thing that happens that I've seen happen in this country and other countries, was how in this country at that time, Vietnamese were seen as lesser than. They were geeks, they were slant eyes, and I think that these are things that play into our own insecurities or whatnot, but it's things that when we hear something like that, maybe it just can't get unaddressed any longer. And I don't know how to say it any clearer, but I don't think that that kind of feeling came necessarily from the folks that were over there. I don't know where it came from, but it's not, those kinds of words have not just been attributed to Vietnamese. We still hear those kinds of words attributed to populations in this country.
To answer the young lady, and I do say young because you said you were of the latter end of the war. I was 17 when I volunteered to join. I had a background that was probably a lot different than a lot of people who went into the military. My father was career Army. when I came back, I was told not to wear my uniform because of what was going on in this country. And not only that, when I got back, this country was so torn apart that it was, now that I look back on it, this was like our own Civil War going on at that time. Same Civil War that we fought in the 1860s. It was brother against brother, cousin and father against son. My own brother wouldn't talk to me because he thought I was wrong. There were four of us in the family, all boys. I was the oldest. I was the only one that ended up in the service. After I came back and got out, I did not tell anyone that I was a Vietnam vet because it was a stigma. That's what we were thrown in our, that's what was thrown in our faces. It was a stigma to be a Vietnam vet. And you saw in the newspapers, you know, Vietnam vet goes crazy, starts shooting people, so forth and so on. Well, you know, they never put in there that bankers go crazy and shoot people too, but it was a Vietnam vet that went crazy. So I eventually went to work for the state, right up the street at the state hospital in 1975, right when the war was ending, when the pictures were taken of the helicopters taking people off the top of the embassy. And it wasn't even then that I would admit that I was a Vietnam veteran, because here I was working with people who were having psychological problems, and people considered me damaged goods. So you didn't want people like me working with people like those. It was that simple. It wasn't until the wall was built, and we went down, I marched in that parade. As we left the staging area to head out onto the parade route, none of us knew what was going to happen. We didn't know if people were going to be throwing tomatoes at us, jeering us, calling us names, like they had been for more years than anybody can care to count. But when people started clapping and cheering, and there was even a little young girl that came out and gave me a flower, that's when we knew that it was okay again to be a Vietnam veteran. And that's when I finally admitted that I was one. The other thing the young lady said back there was that, you know, we had different names for the enemy. Well, the enemy, I'll tell you right now, I respected them as people, as soldiers, as human beings. But as we all that have been there know, war is inhuman. And we have to deal with it in our own minds the way that will least affect us. So we dehumanize people. We call them goose because then they weren't people.
Well, and you raise an interesting point, and I think one of the things that the film emphasizes on every possible side is the silence, just the ways in which people were not talking about, whether it was telling people you serve, whether it was telling people who's on the North Vietnamese side that their children had died. There was just this silence. And did that register with anybody in the audience as causing you to reflect back, maybe? Or,
hi, my name is Sherry Bisson from Anacostia, New Hampshire. My brother and I lost my brother in Vietnam. So I'll go through this, but I think for me, in the film, when they showed the family sending the recorded tape to their son, because for me, I'm hoping to, I was very young, I was two when I lost my brother, so because it was such a hidden war for so long, I didn't really get to learn about it. My family didn't talk about it. My father dealt with it in other ways. perspective. So I'm hoping to see that more. But that's been the difficult side for coming from having lost somebody in that work.
Thank you for sharing that. I thank you right here on your left.
Thank you. Yeah, I acknowledge that there were people against the war who failed to distinguish between the policies of our government and the soldiers who were carrying out the policies that they were ordered to carry out. I don't know how extensive some of these anti-soldier manifestations were, but people report a lot of these kinds of things. But I also say the vast majority of the anti-war movement was not anti-soldier and anti-sailor and anti-Air Force people. It was quite the contrary. In fact, during the Vietnam moratorium, I was in college and I was the co-chair of the moratorium on our campus. My co-chair was a Vietnam vet, as were many people in the anti-war movement. So I think one of the problems we have with facing wars in our foreign policy based on war is that we fail to distinguish between those who are tasked with carrying out those policies and the policies themselves. And I think we do that in with respect to Iraq and Afghanistan and so forth. And I think I was thinking about why is it that we have not had the same kind of protests for subsequent wars that have been just devastating as well to so many of our military people, but so many of the people in other parts of the world. And I think part of it is that we've been unable to disentangle the support for our military and the support for the policies. It's a very different thing.
And do you think the film does a good job of humanizing the war by going so deep into like personal biographies of frontline soldiers and protesters?
Oh, yes, you know. I think it does. One other thing about the film is you asked about, you know, whether the film has a certain argument, point of view, whether it's biased in one way or another. I think what they're trying to do is show the facts. You know, the facts do have a perspective to them. But I think they do a good job.
Thanks for those remarks, because I think that I've talked to many vets. I have many vets as students, including Ken Sinfield and the student government, and had many conversations with him as well. And I think the one thing that united us was our deep, deep, and bitter disappointment in the government and the generals who led that war. Not the soldiers. It wasn't ever aimed at the soldiers.
And then back here, we have down here.
To the gentleman sitting at Corolla for me, what you mentioned about entangled, points of view and information and stuff like that. This is part conjecture, part question for anyone who can answer, but I think it is fair to say that as history goes and we accumulate information, we still, miss so much that we fail to take into account and mix them all in with all the other stuff that we're still entangled together, and that's why we're here today.
That feels like an appropriate note to kind of, unless anyone has anything, I don't want to cut anybody off, but I think to transition into the recognition that this is a screener. So the actual film comes out, I believe, on the 17th. 18 hours, 10 episodes, And so this is meant to kind of initiate a conversation and hopefully stimulate, give permission to talk about things that maybe haven't necessarily been talked about.
I'd just like to say also that on your way out, we have another handout for you. It's different from the one that you got going in. This one will have the schedule on NHPTV, New Hampshire PBS, for the series itself. And on the back of the sheet is a way to access the PBS Vietnam website so you can read your stories. So this is different from the one you got going in, if you would like it.
We also have patches for any of the Vietnam vets who are here. First come, first serve on those. Maybe, can you run the, maybe Dan, could you try to catch people going out with those?
And I'll turn things over to Don, I think. But on this, on a personal note, to all the people who did serve in the Vietnam War, just as welcome home. Thank you for what you did. Yeah.
We didn't have experts up here because this is about your personal experience, and articulating that experience is really important. And we have a number of different ways that we'd like you to consider sharing your experience. I'm not sure if we're ready to roll, but we have a number of pieces for you to consider in the handout. Is the National PBS Story Share. If you have photographs, any ephemera that you want to take a picture of, a caption of a moment, there's a national site, and you can upload video, stills, a poem, maybe a picture of a letter you received, and each state is going to be represented on this national site, and it's pretty much a virtual story wall. NHPTV, as part of a grant that allowed us to host this series, has collected some stories, and we collected one that was at the visiting wall at UNH, which I hope to show you. But also, I wanted to reintroduce Dan Marchak from Vetflix, who's our partner in this endeavor, and he's really interested, if you're a veteran and you'd like, because some of these stories we just heard, just the beginning of what are really meaningful and important stories to be shared, we just give him your name and phone number or address, email address, and we'll follow up. We really want to continue this conversation on that very personal level. But I'd like to share one clip, and I don't know how to talk to the booth. Someone's moving. And this is one that we've collected that would be on our own website, but also shared with the national. While he's, let's see if I can do a charade.
He's looking at you.
I didn't know how to communicate. Anyway, you can, this will be available on nhptv.org/Vietnam. And I just want to thank you all